وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّاهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا.
اوكي، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Firstly, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. The topic we're going to discuss this evening is going to be titled The King, The Queen and The Naughty Prince. Okay, the king, the queen, and the naughty prince. And it's going to be something, inshallah, which will help all of us understand ourselves better, and something that will make ourselves understand others as well as ourselves, okay, in the way that we interact with one another, and our emotions inside and what goes inside. Now, to understand what I'm talking about, first I'm going to give you a story. And when I give you the story, you might think, well, what on earth is this story about? But once I start breaking up the story and telling you what parts relate to what, you'll understand what I'm talking about. So to begin with, there was this palace and this kingdom in the past, and the palace had many servants inside, and the palace also had a king, okay, a queen, that was his wife, and also they had only one son. One son. They never had any other children. And that son was a bit of a naughty son, okay, because he got spoiled. After so many years, they had this one son. And you know what happens when they get suddenly one child after so long? You tend to spoil it a little bit. You tend to give it what he wants, okay? Now, this young prince has grown all the way up to, you know, 10 years old. And the king and queen are already, you know, well in their adulthood. And this palace is a very weird palace. Okay, I know it's a story, but I'm going to relate the story to our lives in a little while, so stay with me. This palace is a bit of a weird palace because there's a magical stick inside this palace. And this magical stick, whoever gets hold of it, out of the three, they can control. And they can literally control the guards, and they can control the servants, they can control the cooks, and they can control whoever else is, you know, not a royal person. Okay, so what usually happens here in this palace is when the king has the magic stick in his hand, you know, they're all spellbound by him. He's the one who's the judge, he's the one who tells people what to do. And usually the king in this palace has got a balanced mind, he's got a logical mind. He keeps things in place. And when the king has the stick in his hand, normally the palace is running well and fine. Okay? Because he keeps the queen under control, and he keeps the naughty prince under control. And he tells the servants to look after the things. You know, there's a lot of work to do and so on. So the king gets everyone to do their work, and everyone obeys the king because he's a person of authority. And he's a person who's fair, and he's not too judgmental and so on. So he comes across very well with everyone. Now, what happens is the queen is always wanting to grab hold of the magical stick. And also the naughty prince wants to get it. Now, if the queen gets hold of this magical stick, what happens is she now gets command over the servants of this palace. And her approach is very different. The way she rules is very different. She gets the magical stick in her hand, and the king... better stay away. Of course, the king's going to try and take it off her, but, you know, she's going to have the power. While she's got it in her hand, she's got the power. And when she actually starts to exercise the power, what she does is, she's a very emotional person. And she's got highs and lows. And sometimes she goes off on a rant. She'll start telling off servants. Sometimes she's in a sort of sad and depressed mood, so she just wants to be to herself. And she just, you know, all the servants just want to just be to themselves as well. You know, nothing's really happening. Sometimes she's really excited. And everyone's happy, in a very happy mood. And there's a lot of turbulence when the queen gets it. Sometimes she's focused on one thing, so much so in the kingdom, that everyone's occupied with that one thing. Maybe it might be just, you know, redecorating a certain room or something. Everyone's occupied. Now, other things will start you know, not being done on time because she's just got her focus on this one room, and all the servants will do exactly what she wants to do when she's got the stick in her hand. Now, of course, the best time when the queen has it is when she's in a very happy mood because everyone's happy. The servants are also happy and people generally are happy. But then she will go down and she might have anxiety. She might have worry. And that brings a bad mood to the palace because everyone's sort of worried. And it's her mood that transpires to all of the servants because she's got the stick. Now, the king, whenever he's got the chance, again, after a little while, he's going to grab the stick back again and take it. And once he takes it, everything's back to normal. He'll put things back to normal again. You know, like the servants will run around just as they used to before, and everything's going to be hunky-dory in this palace for a little while. And God forbid, if the naughty prince comes up and he takes the stick from his daddy, then what happens is, today is going to be party day. You understand? Because he's naughty prince. When he has it in his hand, by God, everyone's in chill out mood. You know, chill out mood? Everyone, you know, wants to have their say. Everyone wants to do what they want. Everyone's got freedom all of a sudden. You know, people don't have to wear their uniforms anymore. People can just, you know, the servants can move around where they want. They've got, literally, the palace is like their playground now. And the prince, he loves it. Oh my God, bring him chocolate, bring him cakes, bring him pudding, bring him all the things that might rot his teeth and make him a chubby little child. He don't care. The servants will do what he wants and he's on a field day. And of course, when the naughty prince has it, the king and queen are, you know, behind him trying to get it. And he's running around and all the servants are having a field day. They don't care because the prince dictates what they do at that moment. Not the king, not the queen. And at that moment, there's a bit of chaos. There's quite a bit of chaos. And if the prince has it too long, there's going to be a lot of chaos inside the palace. Until usually what happens is when the naughty prince has got it and he's doing his little, relaxation with everybody, usually the queen is the first one to get it off the prince, and sometimes the king, but usually the queen. When the queen gets it in her hand, what's her state going to be? Is she going to be happy or is she going to be angry? Tell me. She's going to be angry. Now, once she's angry, all the servants are angry as well. Oh my God, what a mess. What have you done? This and that. And reprimanding the prince. What have you done? You get in your place, little boy, and you stop doing that and so on. So she'll go on a little rant. She'll be quite, you know, upset with what he's just done. Servants will also be fired up because she's fired up and so on. And then after a while, the king will manage to get the staff again, the stick again in his hand, and things are normal again. Now, what happens? There's one more person I have to introduce to you, okay, before I break this whole story up to you. The one other person that is in this palace who doesn't usually take the stick in his hand like that. He doesn't come and grab the stick. But it's only the king that is able to offer that and pass it to him. And the king has the power to take it back off him. Only the king can pass it on to him. And this is the wise minister. Okay? There's a wise minister in this palace. And the wise minister is the most wise of all. He's an old man, okay, long, lengthy beard. He's a wise man. He's traveled the lands. He's seen it all. He's read libraries and libraries of books, okay? And this wise man is the wisest you can find out of the whole of the kingdom. He's the wisest man you can get. And when you need some words of advice, there's nobody better than to go to the wise man. But there's one problem, which is the wise man will be there, but the wise man is passive. He won't actively take the stick off you to dictate to you what you should do. No, he will remain passive when the king comes and says, please take the stick for a little while and tell me how to rule this kingdom. When the king does that, then the wise man will speak. But of course, it's up to the king how long he allows that staff to stay in his hand before he takes it back. But when the wise man speaks, Everyone's in awe of this wise man. Even the queen, the naughty prince, the servants, the king, They're all mesmerized by the words that come out of the wise man. And when the wise man says something, everyone knows that, you know what, that's the best thing to do. However, the battle begins again. As soon as the king takes the staff again, then the battle begins. The queen wants to grab it off him, and so does the naughty prince. And it's a battle. Who's going to try and keep that stick in their hand? Okay? Now the servants are there, and they'll do exactly with whoever has got the stick. And there's always this case in this weird palace. In this weird palace, this is always the case every single day. Sometimes you get good 3 days of the king having it in his hands. Sometimes you get some two bad rough days when turbulent days when the queen has it. And sometimes you get some other day where you might have a free day when the prince has it. And worst case is going to be if the prince can get hold of it and keep it for a week or 2 weeks. Oh my God, the damage he can cause. And everyone's going to love it. When he's got it, everyone's loving it. See, everyone's thrilled by the fact that the prince has got it. But they know as soon as it's handed over to the queen or the king, they know there's mess to tidy up. All right? Now, you might think that what on earth is this story about, man? You're just wasting our time after Isha in the masjid and telling us some jackanory. Right? This is no jackanory. I'm going to relate to your life now. I'm going to relate to my life now. Okay? I said to you that there was a kingdom. I said to you there was a kingdom, and in this kingdom there was a palace, and this palace had servants, okay, many servants. The hand you've got, the hands you've got, the feet you've got, the eyes you have, the ears you have, the tongue, the body, okay, the legs, the arms, everything. That all these things that we've got, the fingers and so on, they are the servants. You all got that? They are the servants. When I said to you that this kingdom has got a king, a queen, and a naughty prince, what I meant by that was we've got a king, okay, this is our logical mind, a queen, our emotions inside, and the naughty prince, which is the ego or the desires we have inside, the passions and the desires we have inside. Or you can sum it up as the ego, the nafs. Okay? Now, the stick, the magical stick, is the human's free will. The human has free will. We choose what we want to do. We can choose to become logical, we can choose to become emotional, and we can choose to follow our ego. That the human makes a choice of. That's the magical stick inside us. But we're all these three people inside us, that's us. All the three people inside us, that's us. Okay? Now, what happens is this. If we are balanced and we think straight and we're having a good day, no emotions are bothering us, no ego is coming in our way, no desires, nothing that's distracting us. Only thing is my logical mind says I should do this, yeah, I need to do this. That's when the king has got the power inside us. That's the king sitting in there. He's got the power to make us make logical decisions and decisions that are going to be fair and square. Now, once the king is in power, once he's got the free will, the magical stick, what happens is all the servants, all the fingers, the arms and so on, all the servants and everything here, they will all basically do as the king wants. So when you've got a logical mind, your eyes will look at what you're supposed to look at and so on, and your tongue will say logical things. Like, it won't say things that are horrible to people. No, it will measure things. Do you understand? It will have it in control. It'll control the tongue, control what you listen to, or control where you go, control what you touch, what you do. All of it is done by the king inside here that is in control. And who puts him in control? I put him in control. You put him in control. And you've got a king inside you. I've got a king inside me. Is that clear with everyone? Yep. What happens sometimes is there's a battle going on inside us. And the battle is that the emotions sometimes want to take over. Sometimes we feel these emotions inside us. when it has the power, when it gathers itself, when it gets the free will and it goes towards the emotions inside the heart, let's call it emotions are up here, the heart, then the king has lost power. For example, somebody has, now this happens, right? Somebody has just been, you know, triggered off by somebody else, all right? They're cheesed off, they're really upset and angry. Now what happens that time is that the emotions come up. Yeah. Now that time the king is not in power. The queen is in power. You understand? It's the emotions inside every single one of us. The queen is in power and the queen chooses to react. And because the queen that time is in power, the emotions, they take over the arms, they take over the tongue, they take over the eyes, they take over everything else. They take over the servants. Are you all clear with me? Right? That time when a person's angry, it's like, yeah, your whole body changes, it tenses up. You know, you're ready for what? And if the queen becomes struck with anxiety, then the whole body gets struck with anxiety. The head lowers itself. The hands, arms lower themselves. There's always worry. There's worry. Look, king is not in power. It can't work. The logical sense is the one that could take it out of this anxiety, but no, because the emotions are flared up inside, they take over. And if there's excitement, same thing. If it's happy, there's emotions, yeah, the queen is happy inside, yeah, I'm really happy, I'm really having a nice day, yeah, I'm buzzing, whatever. All the whole arm, everything, my face will light up, everything, all my servants, they follow the emotions inside me. Whether it's jealousy, whether it's love, whether it's malice, whether it's hatred, whether it's trying to have arrogance, whatever it is, it's all in the emotions. It's all in the emotions. And it has an effect on my body. And sometimes what happens is our ego gets the better of us. Now these are passions and desires we have inside us. They're not emotional. They're not logical. They are passions, desires we want to fulfill. You know, we want to do something, we want to break the rules a bit, you know, we want to do something that we're not supposed to do. That's when the ego takes over. And when the ego is taken over, oh my God, the ego is taken over. You understand? Like, for example, someone sitting there and he's on his smartphone, whatever, he starts flipping over. First, the king was in charge. The king said, hey, whatever you look at is going to be okay. Yeah, fine. After a little while, somehow the prince took over. And now the person is looking at haram stuff he's not supposed to look at, and there's a field day. Their eyes look at things that they're not supposed to look at, the ears listen to things they're not supposed to listen to, the tongue talks about things it's not supposed to talk about, and there's a whole haram being committed because the ego is in charge and all the whole body is having a field day. And of course, like I said to you, the prince, when the naughty prince gets in charge and the servants are listening to the naughty prince, usually who gets hold of the naughty prince? Who gets hold? The queen. Now all of a sudden when the naughty prince has had his moment and you've just looked at things you're not supposed to look at, all of a sudden you feel inside you, oh my God, what did I do that for? Huh? Why did I do that for? I said to myself, I'm not going to do it again. Right? There's remorse, there's guilt, there's anger. Where's that coming? Who's in charge now? Who's in charge? The queen. Your emotions are in function right now. And after a while, when that phase has gone over, and you're thinking, okay again, who's in charge? The king. You all got that? Are you with me? Yeah. Are you guys with me? Yeah? All right. Now, this battle is within us every single day. And if you want to understand what's happening to you, what are you doing, it depends who has got the magical stick. It depends where your attention is going towards. Who has actually grabbed the stick? Whoever you give it to, they will rule inside you. You can give it to your logical side. You can enhance that. You can give it to your emotional side and that will drive you. You can give it to your ego side, that will drive you. It's up to you. So typically, for example, when someone is in love, let me give you a clear example. Sometimes these youngsters, they see someone they fall in love with. It doesn't have to be youngster, it could be someone who's old as well, yeah? You'd be lucky, mate, if you get it, yeah? You know what I'm saying? So you fall in love. The person is in love. Now, the people around him say, listen, bro, she's not good for you. He says, she has to be good for me. No, she's not good. She's a woman who we see loose in the marketplace. She's roaming around. She's seeing boys, other boys. Nah, that can't be true. And even if he sees her doing that, she must be just shopping. That's all she's doing. Are you saying she's seeing boys? But we saw that she was shaking hands with another boy over there and she talked to him for 5 minutes. That must be her colleague from work. It must be someone she knows, maybe some. He'll make any excuse he can, because who's talking? The queen inside him, exactly. Emotions have taken over. Now what they're talking, look, see, when they're trying to appeal to him, they are talking from where? Their king. Their king, all their kings are talking to this person's queen. And the queen is like, I ain't listening to no king right now. I'm in love. And when I'm in love, I don't care. He wants to just fulfill its love. Okay? It takes sometimes a long time for this emotion to go down, and finally the person realizes the mistake they made, and then the king takes over and said, I told you so. And sometimes what happens is, the prince, for example, you get these youngsters, you get others, you get people, even adults, they do things they're not supposed to do. Let's say, for example, a youngster is got a bad crowd. Okay, they've got drugs or other things that are, you know, situation there. What happens is easily the prince comes into power. Saturday night, out with friends, no parents are there. See, if the parents were there, the parents would act from their kings. Do you understand? The parents' kings would tell this son, you're not doing this. But the parents are not there. It's all my friends. And all the friends, all of their naughty princes are out. You understand? All of their naughty princes are out. Maybe one or two might not have the naughty prince out. Okay? But all of them, most of them are in a mood of, let's go. Let's go and get a car. Let's burn the tires. Let's drive down there. Let's go and see so-and-so. Hey, he's got something there. Let's go to his house. And when they go there, the guy pulls out some stuff from underneath his bed. And then he says, hey, you guys want some? And the naughty prince is out in everybody. Even if at that moment this young kid came along, it's his first time, and his naughty prince says, shall I take that or not? And even if there's fear inside, and the queen comes out and says, no, don't take that. It might be dangerous. Even if that happens, and the king is saying, look, don't do that. Even if all of this is happening, the naughty prince has still got the stick in the hand. And he could be wise enough at that time to allow the king to take it off him. But, you know, most likely, he's just going to say, let me just try. Let me show that I'm also someone who's brave, who's got the power, who's like these. I mean, if I don't take it right now, they're going to call me all sorts of names. They're going to tell me that I'm just a little, you know, whatever. I'll be bullied after this. So he'll take it. That's the naughty prince. Even an adult, sometimes an adult does something. They do something wrong. They do some damage, and they'll do some more damage above that. And they'll try and hide it by burying the evidence, whatever. It's all the naughty prince inside. Now, I said to you, there's one other individual. The other individual was the wise minister. Now, the wise minister, one thing I didn't tell you about the wise minister is, how is he so wise? The wise minister has actually got a room inside the palace, and that room has got a closet, and that closet has got two books, and those two books are the sources of all the wise man's wisdom. He goes to the closet, he opens the closet, takes the two books out, he studies them, and when he speaks after that, whoa, it's game over. The king is in awe, the queen is in awe. The naughty prince just has to put his head down and say, these are the best things that we've heard. Now, who's this wise minister? The wise minister in us is this ruh, is the ruh, the soul. Each and every one of us has a soul. Soul is the one that goes out to the akhirah. Soul is the one that was pumped inside this body at the time of birth. Soul is the thing that will live on, you know, in Jannah, in a different body forever. But this body is going to be gone. That soul is ruh. The ruh is always inclined towards Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The ruh is always connected. Now the ruh has got what? When the ruh will take the Quran, this is book number one. When the ruh looks at the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or the Ahadith. When the ruh, the soul inside us, when it connects with the Quran and the Sunnah, and it's filled in with that, it will only speak from there to the whole of the body. See, the ruh inside us is always connected towards the akhirah, always connected towards Allah. It's a good person inside us. It's the most wisest thing inside us. However, just as I said to you before, the ruh doesn't fight inside to try and take the stick. It'll only be the king or the queen or the naughty prince. But the ruh can have the king hand it over to him. Hand the magical stick over to him. The king inside us can say to our ruh, ruh, what do we do here? And the ruh is the one, if you allow the ruh to expand, the soul, when it hears the Quran, see, you know, when we hear the Quran, for example, and most of you sitting here, you might not know what the Quran actually means, okay? But when you hear,
وقال الذين لا يرجون لقاءنا لولا أنزل علينا.
When you hear those sounds, then it's not your king that connects. It's not your queen that connects. Though she has a part to it, the king also has a part to it. It's not just your prince that connects. It's the ruh, it's the wise minister. Because that part of us straight away gets attracted to it. And the whole of the king, the queen, the prince, all of us is in awe when that happens.
سيقول السفهاء من الناس ما ولاهم عن قبلتهم التي كانوا عليها قل لله المشرق والمغرب يهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم.
When you hear that, you know what's content inside you? It's the ruh that comes into power. When you hear that and you feel calm inside, it's the ruh, it's the wise minister that suddenly has been handed over something. And when he's calm and when he's dictating, oh my God, everything's in awe. You know, sometimes we come and we listen to something awesome. Sometimes we do some dhikr and we connect with Allah Azza wa Jal, whether it's in salah, in tilawa, just normal dhikr, just contemplation. Sometimes some of us have gone to the Haramain. Sometimes some of us have felt very close to Allah in Ramadan. You know, all those times it happens, you know which one is really connected? It's the wise minister. And the wise minister, if you fill it in with the two books, from the two books, which is Quran and the Sunnah. When I say book, I'm calling the Sunnah book, but obviously it's a collection of books. But when you fill it in and you take what Allah and His Messenger have said, the king knows, your logical side knows, your queen knows, your emotions know, your prince, your ego, all of it knows that, you know what, these are the best words ever. You all understand? These are the best words ever. And they fall completely, you know, in front of it, submissive. But what happens is, very soon, the king will take it back again. And as soon as the king takes it back again, there's going to be a fight with the emotions. There's going to be a fight with the ego to take it over. Now, brothers and sisters who are listening, why am I saying this? Why I'm saying this is because we have got this battle inside us from birth all the way till death. This battle is going to go inside us. It depends who you put in charge. The best kingdom you can have of your body is when the prince is being controlled by the queen. So the ego is under the emotions. And the emotion says, hey, you dare take that. You dare take a field. Now, if the emotions are controlling that, and then the king, our logical side, says to the emotional side, the queen says, hey, madam, listen. Yeah, you listen. You just stay where you are, okay? You just look after the prince. Don't let him get out of
check, and you, wherever you are, you don't take the stick off me. Okay, let me tell you and the prince what to do, and let me control all these servants. But the king can't do it on his own. If the king doesn't connect to the Ruh, the Quran, the Sunnah, if the king doesn't connect to all of that and take guidance from that, the king can be lost. Because there are a lot of people on this earth who've got a king working brilliant, but they've got no Ruh that guides it. Do you understand? They're brilliant people out there. Don't get me wrong. They're balanced people. But they've got no soul that is connected to Allah and His Messenger. And if they haven't found that side, they'll still be lost without that soul, without the Quran and the Sunnah, without that closet that has got the two books that give the information to the soul. So if the soul, the ruh, okay, which is our soul, if that is under the Quran and Sunnah, and if the ruh is able to say to the logical side, listen, this is the guidance you need, rule like this, and the logical side is, okay, fine, I will control the emotions, and I will also control the desires that I've got. If that happens, then it's a perfect person. You've got fully control of yourself. You've got full control of yourself. And if you can carry this on from now on, when you've heard this, all the way till you die, then mashallah and tabarakallah, you've got a wonderful life. But anytime you felt that, oh my God, I'm having a bad day here, you better know that something's gone wrong. Either your prince is taken over, or your queen has taken over, and you better get the stick back, because otherwise there's going to be chaos. Okay, and some people, what happens is they don't realize they're going through this battle. Some people just don't realize there's been years and years of them functioning just with the prince. You know, like some druggie comes out, some person comes out of the streets, and suddenly he comes to the masjid, or suddenly he turns to the deen. You know, for years he allowed his prince to talk, to say whatever. Do you guys understand? You could be in the years. Some people, their emotions are in power for years, whether it's a man or a woman. Look, I'm not being sexist in any way by saying that the queen's emotional one. It's just an example to get you in. But in my example, the men have got queens, and the women have got queens, and the men have got kings, and the women have got kings as well. Like in the story of Sulaiman alayhi salam, when Bilqis said, right, what do you guys say to this letter that has come to me? Remember that story? When she gets a letter, she says, what do you say? And you know, the servants, or all her courtyard sort of ministers, they all say, and the army, they say, you know what? They say, we've got power. We've got the mind. We can take him on. They're speaking from where? We can take him on. They're speaking from where? Emotions. They were threatened. They had emotion. They were speaking from here, from the queen's side. When she said, let me send him a gift and see how he responds, she was testing him out. What was she using? Her king. And therefore she stopped herself from a lot of, you know, a great war that could have taken place between her and Sulaiman alayhi salam. She did that. When you look at the lives of all the prophets, you will see that they don't have any of their whims and desires or egos taken over at all. That's completely under, you know, control. But their emotional side still doesn't get a chance. They're ruling from here, and the wise minister, they're ruling from there. And if you analyze what is going on. So for example, let me give you another example, yeah? If you're home and you're thinking, why is my dad speaking like this to me for? Just think to yourself. I don't want you to go to your dad today and say, Dad, that queen of yours, you better control her. Whoa, boy. You're going to get some slap, boy. But I just want you to understand what is going on. Because sometimes what happens is, when the mum and dad are in a little bit of a, you know, turbulence, and they're fighting with one another, what usually is happening is they're both talking from their queen. Do you understand? They're both talking from the queen. And it's very strange. People can even change power, give different powers to different people when they talk to different people. Like, so for example, yeah? The man, he's in his house. He's like talking to his wife and say, hey, what? And his wife saying, what do you mean? And they're in the middle of a call and suddenly the phone rings. Okay? Suddenly the phone rings and he's got to take this call. It's from his workplace. Now, just now he's talking to his wife and he's like, what's leading him? The queen, emotional queen, right? Suddenly he takes the phone in his hand. He says, oh, Mike, all right. Yeah, how's it going? How's it going, Mike? Yeah, all right, yeah. Tomorrow, 7 o'clock on the dot. You make sure that you're there. Yeah, everything all right? Yeah, make sure. Yeah, I'll bring the paperwork down. You'll be all right with that. Yeah, don't worry about it. Puts it down. You, la, 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 la. What happened there? Who was talking from there? The king. He switched this, right? King for that one, queen for this one. And sometimes what people do is in the same household, they can develop a lot of emotions for one person. Bad emotion, good emotion. It could be bad, it could be good. When you develop those emotions, you get controlled by the queen each time you're in contact with that person. But then when you're in contact with another person, you switch it to maybe the king. And then what happens is some people have three, right? So for example, you talk to, let's say, your parents. You talk from here, the king. You talk to your wife, you talk from here sometimes, the emotions. And you talk to your friends, you talk to them from here. Ego, naughty prince, yeah. We just go down there, man, we just do that. But yeah, let's just do it. Just get out of it, you know, break the rules. That's prince with them, queen with the wife, king with the parents. People have all of this. And what's happening is sometimes what happens is that even... You talk about it, that there's a couple here. Every day, they're going through different shifts. Sometimes every day, they're going through different shifts. So when it's a good day, both of them, husband and wife, could be talking to each other from the queen, but the queen's happy now, see? The queen's not angry. The queen's thrilled and happy, in love. So both of them can speak to each other from the queen, which is going to be fine. It's going to be fine. This works because his queen is happy. Her queen is happy. They're both sitting there having a wonderful time together, talking to each other. It's going to be fine. It's a nice day. But suddenly, after a few hours, it could be next day, whenever, you know, something's triggered one of them off. Okay? So his queen gets a bit upset with her queen. Don't forget, they're very emotional, they're turbulent. So his queen could get upset. Her queen could be, you know, not that upset. Hey, what's going on? Hey, why are you saying that to me for? Hey, why? You know, because she's still in a happy mood until she can switch. She can switch. If at that time when she switches, she says, hey, I better let my king take over. If she says that, then she'll start thinking straight. Before she says anything, she'll think straight. She says, no, better not say that. No, don't you dare say that. No. That's going to get you in trouble. See, the king is the one that thinks ahead. The queen don't think ahead. The queen wants to blurt it out now. And I'm saying it's revenge time. The king thinks ahead. Queen and prince, they don't think ahead. It's only the king that can think ahead. So if the power is assigned to the king in the person will know that this person's angry with me, this person's upset with me, but you know what? I'm going to zip up. I'm going to stay quiet. I'm going to allow the storm to go by. I'm going to calm down. I'm going to cool it off. It's going to hurt for the queen not to take. The queen's dying to take. Give me the stick. Let me say whatever. No. And the king says, because the king's got servants, right? The tongue, the eyes, the ears, everything under control. The arms under control. The king stays and says, cool. Okay, fine. Say what you want. Have you met people like that even in an emotional situation, they stay calm? Have you met those people, guys? Come on. Yes? Well, those are the people who assign a lot of power to the king. Even in emotional situations, we can learn. We can learn how to allow the king to be in power. We've all got this power inside us. You choose, I choose who you want to give the power to. I remember once when I was about 16 years old, and I had a friend. And this friend, I used to hang around with him every single day. And one day what happened is, I knew he used to smoke. I never smoked. I knew he used to smoke. And he, you know, when he was sometimes walking, he takes his fag out, he just, you know, lights it up and he has it, fine. He has it, I don't have it, okay? But there was a good friendship between me and him. And after so many days, what happened one day is he took his cigarette out, he lighted it, and he said to me, he said, "Do you want to try it?" Now, of course, me being his friend, you know, we're going to be prince and prince, you understand? Not in that sense, you know what I'm saying? Like, but you know, prince and prince, right? So at that time, you know what I did? I switched straight away to my king. I just did it. I said to him, "Listen," I said, "I'm your friend. But if you ever offer me that again, our friendship is over." Have I made that clear to you? I just straight away, just tell him straight, without getting emotional with him. I just tell him straight up, "If you ever offer that to me again, friendship is over." He said, "I understand." Fine. He just took his cigarette back. He just carried on having it. I didn't ever bother saying that to him again, because he never bothered ever handing it over to me or offering it to me. Do you understand? We have the power to assign the power to whoever we want. It's all in our mind. And if you choose on a bad day, see, when it's all gloomy and people are in a bad, they're having a bad time, you can choose whoever you want to give the power to and you can change your mood. You don't have to be like everybody else who's moody. You don't have to be. Let me give you a story. You might find this really awkward, yeah? We were in 2008, we were in Spain. But going back a good few years now, okay? We're in Spain, all, you know, there's five men, you know, and my colleagues and so on, with all our wives, children, everyone, we went, okay? We hired two big vans. We were out there in the you know, in Spain, and the place that where our hotel was in the middle of nowhere. It was like in some mountainous area, okay? It wasn't a proper hotel, but it was like a place where to stay. It was in the middle of the mountains. When you took your sat-nav, your GPS, to that location, sat-nav did not work. You understand? Sat-nav couldn't find any connection. Finito. You understand? Gone. So what happens is, we're coming back to our place, and now it's 12 o'clock in the night. Completely dark, middle of the mountains, no street lights. It is dark. Okay, plus on top of that, we have to go up the mountain. You know, the mountain's got it's got roads at the side, yeah? Up the mountain. And you know what? There's no barriers. If you fall, you end up in Jannah. You know what I'm trying to say, like, yeah? Inshallah. Okay. That's how I look at it. See, you could always think positive. I always think, if I die, inshallah, Jannah. You know, you got to think positive. You know what I'm saying? You can't say, "Oh my God, Jannah." You can be worried for the rest of your life, man. So the thing is, we're going up this mountain and down and up and down. And you know what? There's no GPS. We're just following instinct. There's two vans, one ahead of us. Some brothers and their wives are in there. And this van where me, some other brothers and our wives are inside this one. And we're following that one. Okay, they're ahead of us. We're following that one. And we're going up and down the mountains, up and down. We're losing track. And a 20-minute journey became a two-hour journey. In the middle of the night, you know, you just can't see anything, right? And it's dangerous, and you're on the mountains, and you know what? You got so many fears. Because, you know, at that moment, if you fear, you can slob it all in, man. You can have robbers, you can have hijackers, you can have jinns, you can have all sorts of things that might take over you. If you open your fears, oh my God, anything. Could be a spider, woo-hoo-hoo. Could be anything. See, if you start worrying, you're going to worry about anything. Now, what happened is, we're in the van behind. And I thought to myself, you know what, this is looking really gloomy, this is looking really, really bad, yeah? So I switched. I switched inside and I said, you know what, there's no point of bringing the emotions in and fear and anxiety and oh my God, we're going to die. You know, if you bring all that, everyone's going to be all gloomy. So you know what I did? I switched. I start laughing. I bought Prince out. Yeah. I bought Prince out and I start laughing and I start cracking jokes. And you know, slowly, everyone in my van, they all got into cracking jokes and we laughed so much, yeah? You might think I'm crazy, but I did this. And there's a reason why I did this, because I thought, you know what, if you're going to go to Jannah tonight, we might as well go smiling. You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah? So everyone's cracking up to the extent that some people said to me, stop, let me breathe, stop. You know when your stomach hurts, Yeah, when you laugh so much, your stomach hurts. They said, stop. And we laughed, we laughed, we laughed all the way for the full 2 hours. And when we came out the van, yeah, we were laughing and laughing at the van. We came to a hotel after 2 hours, 2 o'clock in the night. We came out, we were laughing, laughing. And the other guys came out the van, and when we looked at their faces, we thought those guys have seen a ghost. They were so serious. They came out grumpy. They came out mean-faced. They came out like, you know, it's been the worst journey ever in their life. When they came out, we looked at them, we said, what's wrong with you? They said, why are you guys laughing? We said, what's wrong with you? We said, why are you guys laughing? I said, what do you mean we're laughing? We're just laughing. We're on holiday, man. We said, why are you laughing? We said, what would you guys do? They said, we read Surah Yasin. We read, well, which is a good thing, right? Surah Yasin, Surah, you know, we read Surah Jin, we read Surah Nas, Falak, we read our kalimas, we read our this, we read that. We're all sitting there doing zikr, which is good. Look, don't get me wrong, which is really good, all right? Now, we did some zikr as well, don't get me wrong, yeah? We pray to Allah as well, don't get me wrong, yeah? Please. But these guys put fear into it. They had their most probably traumatic experience anyone could have. And those 2 hours were the worst 2 hours they could have experienced. And you know what? I knew in my van, if we all just stayed quiet, that's exactly that would have happened. Yes, du'as we did, don't get me wrong. Dhikr we did, yeah, don't get me wrong. But then I switched the mood and we all have a nice laugh, yeah? But those guys talked about, oh my, not just du'as and dhikr, they start saying, we're scared of things. We said, what are you scared of? They said, jinns. Are you scared of jinns? Why are you scared of? Because jinns are on mountains. Really? We didn't see any. Even if we did see any, I'm sure they would have like legged it because of the amount of laughter that we had, right? We basically had a wonderful time. Now, the thing was, in that mood, see, what I want to tell you is that when you're in that position where everyone's moody, you don't have to be moody. When everyone's having a bad day, you don't have to have a bad day. When everyone's thinking, oh my God, it's the worst thing ever happened, you don't have to. Like, I'll give you an example. We just had Brexit, right? Everyone's like, everyone's kicking their feet every day. Brexit, oh my God, this has gone up, that's gone up. Oh my God, every day. Yeah? Before Brexit, I was telling people, you know, don't vote for it, man. Just vote to remain. I was one of them. I put my hands up. I talked about it before. I talked about it after. Some of you might say, I stuck with Allah. No, I voted to stay in. Fine, that's my thing. But then what happened is we lost. Right? As in, we Brexit. Okay? Now they've got a new phrase, they call it regret. You know, regret? Regret. So anyway, what I did straight away that night, as soon as the news came in that, it was the night or the morning, the votes were counted, and we basically, it means Brexit happened. You know the silly thing was? The biggest Google hit the next morning, the biggest Google question was, in the morning, yeah? This is the morning after Brexit has happened. The biggest Google question was, what is Brexit? You idiots. You idiots. You didn't even know what it was. What's Article 50? They didn't even know what it was. And they voted for it anyway. Khalas. What I did is, I'm not going to stay there. You know, I heard colleagues telling me, they went into work and it was like somebody had died. They went into work and people were mourning. People just had slopped in front of the computers and thinking, What happened? This is in London. I'm not talking about other cities. Other cities, they probably thought, yeah. After a little while when they woke up, right? But anyway, over here, people weren't very happy in London. And you know me? I was just the same. Yesterday, I was having a good time. Today, I'm going to have a good time. All right? Because you know what? If you're going to be moody because of fear, because of what you think might happen, Brexit, even today is really bad. Look, every day we're hearing in the news, this is going to happen by 2017, it's just going to collapse, the Asian index is you know, turbulent at the moment, this, that, all this stuff. You know, I read it and I think, so what? Seriously, so what? Even if I have to pay extra pounds and extra money and I'm going to, you know, suffer like the rest of you, no way am I going to slowly start saying, oh my God, Brexit, Brexit. You know, if you do that to yourself, you just spoil your own mood because of yourself. So what did I do? I concentrated on a hadith where the Prophet said to us, doesn't matter what the situation is, for the believer it's always good. Doesn't matter what the situation is, the hadith is there. إن أصابته ضراء صبر فكان خير الله. If an affliction befalls him and he has patience, then that thing, affliction, becomes good for him. Now, if Brexit is supposed to be an affliction for us and I have sabr, alhamdulillah. Sabr means sabr as in, I'm not going to say anything, let's just move on with life. Alhamdulillah, not going to complain. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ سَرَّى, when a good thing comes to him, شَكَرَ فَكَانَ خَيْرَ اللَّهِ, and he is thankful, then that's a good thing for him. Right? We never lose. This is the positive mind. You never lose. So if you want to assign at that time to the queen and become emotional, you become emotional. If you want to put it to the king and say, no, everything's fine, then everything's fine. And you choose what you want to be. Now, the reason why I'm saying this is because we end up sometimes as adults being gloomy and being so sad over something which you made a massive issue out of. Massive issue. I mean, I'll be straight with you. Like the other year, a few years back, I need to say this. Some of you might be in this situation. A few years back, some of the schools that my kids were going to, and this happens, by the way, okay? Some of the normal state schools my kids were going to, their exam results and their levels were being played with. They've been tempered with. Why? Because my kids are brown like me. You know what I'm saying, like? Proud to be brown, alhamdulillah. And some people who are not brown, who are more privileged, need to make sure that brown people don't take their place. You know what I'm saying? Now the Brexit land. So what happens is, over time, 2-3 years, whatever, my child's, you know, he's going down in levels when he's actually performing well. And his teachers are playing around, playing a game. Because the thing is, they don't want these brown kids and these other foreign, whatever, whoever they are, to get the most privileged places in, you know, it happens. And my wife was coming every day to me and saying, this is happening, this is happening, this is happening, and so on. And what I did is I said, look, I said, don't worry about it. She said, what do you mean, don't worry about it? He's going to go into a bad grade. He's going to get a bad grade by year 6. Then he goes into year 7 in new secondary school. He starts from the bottom. He's going to carry on going towards the bottom. I said, don't worry about it. Yes, we will deal with it. But we need concrete evidence. Number one, we need concrete evidence. Now, I believe at that time she was talking more from her queen. I was talking a bit more from my king. It happens. And then what happened is I started to direct her, say, look, keep your head screwed on tight. Bring the evidence. When you bring the evidence, concrete evidence they cannot deny, then we'll present that. Let's not go to the school and say, you must be doing this. You have to be doing this. Let's not act on suspicion. So after a while, we gathered some evidence. We managed to get somewhere to the head teacher. She heard, she saw some of it. Some of it wasn't making sense to her from what the teachers were saying. We got some of it in, but you know what? Still, we failed to get the real level that our kid should have had by the end of year 5. I said, don't worry about it. She said, why? I said, because the last exam that he's going to have, his SATs in year 6, is going to be externally moderated. It's not going to be internally moderated. Don't worry about it. Because people externally won't look at who he is, they'll give him his right mark. And that's exactly what happened. For those 2 years, unfortunately, you know, there was a lot of turbulence going on in my house with my wife saying things, you know, like these teachers are doing this. And I had to somehow keep things balanced to the best of what I could. Of course, sometimes even I would get turbulent, like, just, you know, someone's being so emotional with you, sometimes you get a bit emotional, but then you have to cool yourself down. You have to calm yourself down, give the power back to the king and say, look, calm down. Don't worry about it. Let's deal with it properly. Let's not say things that we're not supposed to say. Let's not go out of our way in ways we're not supposed to go. Now, I'm giving this example why some of you at work need this. Some of you at college need this. Some of you at university need this. Some of you at home need this. Some of you in your marital life need this. Whatever it is, go ask yourself who's in power when you talk to those people. Who have you assigned the power to? Have you assigned the power to the king, to the queen? To the you know, down there, to the ego. And in the Quran, according to the Quran, I'll give you the names now. The wise minister inside you is the ruh, I said that. The king inside you, right, is the aql. When Allah says in the Quran, afala ta'qilun, you know what Allah's saying? Allah's saying, don't you want to use your king over your emotions? They came to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they started to deny. They denied the verses. Why? Because it was emotion. It was power. their power is going to go in Makkah Mukarrama. If they agree to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, their whole power, dynasty, everything's gone. So they got arrogant. They became proud over their heritage. They started to get their emotions swelling up, and they wouldn't use their king when they talked to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah said, "Afala ta'qilun? Are you not going to use your aql, your intellect, your logical side? Use it. You'll make two and two, and you'll come to a four instead of two and two and making whatever number you want." So Allah was telling them, "Afala ta'qilun? Use your aql. This is the why. This is the king inside us." And then when people use their emotions, where's that in the Quran? This is the qalb. Allah said, you know, in the Holy Quran, in many different places, the qalb is something that changes. It changes. Right? And its emotions are always going up and down with different turbulences, sometimes good, sometimes bad. Right? You look in the Quran, you'll find many different emotions. Hasad, jealousy. That's something rooted in the qalb. Now it's not from the logical side. You never get jealous. You don't logically get jealous with someone. You emotionally feel jealousy. These are feelings that you have. And the desires, Allah said, hawa. This is the ego, hawa, nafs. Allah used the word nafs. Allah used the word hawa. These are the passions, desires. And Allah says, فَلَا تَتَّبِعْ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ. Don't follow their passions and desires. Don't you succumb to their desires. Don't you become like that. This is addressing the nafs directly. And if you look in the Quran, you will find all of them. You'll find the hawa, the passions, the naughty prince down there. You'll find the emotional queen and all the turbulences people have. According to the Quran, you find them here, and you find the aql, you find the intellect. And above that, you find Allah talks about the person's own self, where they have the spirituality. This is the ruh inside the person. And then Allah says in the whole Quran, He says, if you look in Surah number 39, Surah Zumar, Allah says, ثُمَّ تَقْشَعِرُّ جُلُودُهُمْ وَقُلُوبُهُمْ إِلَىٰ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Their skins, their heart, everything gets inclined towards the remembrance of Allah. When the ruh is in connection. That's the only time it happens. The wise minister comes in connection, it happens. Now look, there are many connections that are happening with us every single day with a lot of people. And I want you to think right now, what is the connection that you're making? You see, sometimes you could even come across a paper, right? Some tabloid papers, they don't appeal to the logic. They appeal to the ego, they appeal to the emotion. Most tabloid papers, they appeal to emotions and to the ego. Broadsheet papers, what they used to call broadsheet papers, they appeal to the right side. The whole thing that went wrong with the Brexit thing, you know what they did? They emotionally derailed half the community through the emotions. Emotions. They told them that, look, this is a fear. You know when the politicians use fear? They're getting your emotions to feel and to make judgments. When really, if at that time you sat back and you said, listen, let me think about this properly. What am I doing? Why? Let me get the facts right. See, most of the time when you get facts together, it's your king working and you make the right judgment. You look far ahead. People were looking at what they didn't even know what Brexit was. They didn't even know what it was, and they were making judgments, and they were following popular hearing, popular say and hearsay and whatever it was. They were acting according to that. Why? Because the emotions were connecting with other people's emotions. I'll give you another example, yeah? When suddenly you've had a bomb go across the world, somewhere some bombing has happened. You know the general reaction of the people in that city? You know. What's thinking? Well, tell me, what's in control inside? Tell me. Emotions. It's a queen. Queen takes over most cases. The queen comes out. Oh my God. Terrorist. All that. You know, these are all people talking from the queen. And then you let the dust settle in. Dust settle down. And after a little while, the people start talking from the king again. No, yeah, what? Not all Muslims are this, not all that, you know, this, that. What are they doing? Well, now they're talking a bit more sense. And some people don't talk sense at all. They just want to always, they've got this, you know, this pre-notion thing about you and what they think of you. Why? Because they haven't allowed their aql, their intellect, to question the emotions and the thoughts inside. Muslims can do this. Non-Muslims can do this. When you don't allow your aql to come in and start rationally making, you know, sense out of what's going on inside you, when you don't allow that part to take authority, then you're going to start making bad decisions. You make bad decisions. Some parents are stuck for a very long time in always reprimanding their children like the queen. They don't think for a while, you know, that they're supposed to treat them in a balanced way. Some parents, very few parents you'll find, they're with the ego. The dad's always like, you know, he don't care. He's always chilled out with his kids. He's always chilled out with his kids. It's not a good thing. If you're always giving your power to your prince and you're ruling your house like that, it's not a good thing. And sometimes, you know, people get it wrong. They move the wrong thing. Like even people, if they have their intellect, fine, but they're not taking from the Quran and the Sunnah, you can make decisions that are bad. You can make bad decisions. According to Muslims, according to Islam. Are there any questions right now before we end? I'm sure you might have some questions that came along. Go on. What is the difference between spirit and soul? Alright, what's the difference between the spirit and soul? I think the two different terms that they use, if you actually go to the biblical source, they use it in a different way. But sometimes they used both words, spirit and soul, are used for one another. Sometimes they use for another. I think in our sense, we don't have to be bothered by the terms. I think just to know that it's a soul. You can say it's a spirit inside, meaning the soul. Sometimes they refer to that as the soul. But sometimes in Christian sort of biblical references, they refer to them as two separate things. Okay. Anybody else? Questions?
Minister, yeah. How can we visualize the wise minister is a good question. I mean, the thing is, look, when the wise minister is when everything inside the body is really calm, and it's something, look, the ruh is connected to the akhirah. It's not just connected to this world. We're not talking about calmness in this world in any other way. We're talking about calmness in a person where they have connected up with their creator. When those feelings come in into a person, then you should know that your wise minister is the one that's just giving you direction. Sometimes all people have experienced this. Sometimes you're in a dua or something and you really feel, you're not emotional, but you're really calm. And you know, you can almost feel like your whole body is breathing differently. You know, sometimes you do dhikr of Allah, and after that your whole body is actually just breathing so calmly. You know what that is? That's your ruh. The ruh has now just got some power. Okay, that's the ruh. Okay. Any other questions? Yes.
What are some practical tips to control your prince?
Ah, that's a very good question.
As you're about to do something, sometimes you know it's the wrong thing, but it's really hard to kind of stop yourself or kind of make it right.
I like that. I like that question. I think this is a very integral part of the whole talk that we're doing. And I think I would have missed out on that if it wasn't for your question. How do you actually maintain the power? What you're saying is, how do you actually give the power to the right things inside you? It's a very good question. Because Allah talks about in the whole Quran. And it says, أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ. Allah says, the hearts will become completely at rest through the dhikr of Allah, through the remembrance of Allah. See, the remembrance of Allah is the only thing. Now, when I say remembrance of Allah, there are three forms of remembrance of Allah. The lowest one is when the tongue is moving with Allah's remembrance, but the mind, the psyche, whatever you want to call it, is absent, is thinking about something else. That's the lowest. You get reward for it, but there's no effect on the body. The higher one is when the mind is thinking of Allah, but the tongue is not moving. So you're just thinking of Allah's, you know, just thinking of His creation, amazing things that He's created and so on, whatever it is, or you might just be thinking about a verse of the Quran, something that is deeply, you know, Quranic or, you know, from the Sunnah. That is a dhikr, or just general contemplation. This is the higher form, and it actually has an effect inside you. Okay, it has an effect inside you and you get more reward for it, but it's not the best. The best is when the tongue and the mind are both doing the dhikr of Allah. So the tongue is moving by saying something, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, Subhanallah, you know, La ilaha illallah, whatever it is, the tongue is moving, or reading the tilawah of the Quran,
But the mind is also present. So it's also thinking about what it's reading, thinking about what it's saying. Okay? When that happens, that's the highest form of dhikr. And this is the very factor that allows the ruh inside this, the wise mist inside, to gain power. So the more of that you give to yourself, the more the wise minister and the king make connection. Right? And your logical side says, you know, because the ruh needs to have its presence. If the wise minister doesn't come and see the king doesn't, you know, think of even giving it to him. So to make a presence of the ruh inside you, and you know, there's many different descriptions of what the ruh is. If you go into the early scholars' writings, some have said the ruh is in one place, some have said it's expands. But ruh is definitely something that expands. Now, some have said it's just over here by the heart, some have said it's down there, some have said it's spread out all over the body. What I say is, and there's many scholars who said this in the past, is the ruh is something that does expand and shrinks, expands and shrinks. The more dhikr you do, the more the ruh expands in the body. The less you do, the more it sort of, you know, just restrains itself in one part of the body. When you do a lot of dhikr, you can almost feel that there's a presence of the ruh inside your body. You can almost feel that your whole body has got some sensation that it doesn't normally experience. When you're really connecting your tongue and your mind with the dhikr of Allah, that's what happens. And the more often you do that, the more of a power it will have automatically from your king. Your logical side will say, you know what, I want to follow it. So what happens is, you know, let me just give you an example. When people get used to sin a lot, it's a prince that is just, you know, in control, full control. But when people get used to the Sharia and to the Quran, the Sunnah, to the good side and so on. By the way, I use that word Sharia. It doesn't mean, you know, kap kap kuk 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 kuk, all right? Whoever's listening to this, all right? Sharia means the Quran Sunnah, okay? So when people actually love to follow the Quran Sunnah, you know what that is? That is when the ruh has gained enough power that the queen just is completely at rest with it. The prince is at rest with it. That's what Allah mentioned. Allah bidhikri la tatma'in. Everything will become so tranquil to the power of that soul inside, or the power of the person deciding, you know, to do good. It just happens automatically. But if a person fails to connect with Allah for a long time, that power will go. Because the ruh will shrink, the prince will come out, take power eventually, and the person will be in the same turmoil. What you've asked is a very important thing, because, you know, a mu'min, a believer who's ignited the right things inside him, who's actually got the ruh inside him. You know, when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was telling us how a person, a believer, is calm in situations when things are turbulent, that's a believer with his ruh that's come out. You know, he's got tawakkul. Tawakkul is a massive thing. Only the ruh can really push forward. The ruh, the soul, works with tawakkul. Why? Because it works with the aql. The aql says, don't worry, there's no worry. It puts the emotions at bay. You don't come out. So it's just the aql and the ruh. Ruh says, look, leave it to Allah. And the aql says, I better make sure I've got the means in place. It will do that. So when you've got your means in place and the ruh says, leave it to Allah, everything works fine. You know, the whole body's fine. And even if something goes wrong, they don't allow the emotions to come in place. The aql says what? Like Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. He said, when something goes wrong, you say, قَدَّرَ اللَّهُ وَمَا شَاءَ فَعَلْ. It was something Allah decreed. It was going to happen anyway. It happened. Let's move on. That's the ruh, tawakkul, and the logical side, قَدَّرَ اللَّهُ وَمَا شَاءَ فَعَلْ, working together. And they have a brilliant, you can be a brilliant human on this earth once you've got that ignited inside you in the right way. Okay, so jazakumullah khair for that question. Okay, any other questions? Yes? Yeah. Yes, 120 days at pregnancy, an angel comes to the fetus and blows in the soul according to hadith of Bukhari. And that's when the ruh actually enters the body. Okay? Any other questions?
When it's come to the nafs and control, sometimes conscience come in between and can be stopped.
Sorry, when the nafs is?
Nafs is getting controlled.
Yeah.
Some conscious will come and stop it, like you shouldn't do it.
Yeah, yeah.
But when it's emotional, it's very hard to
to stop it. Yes, yes, yes. You're right. I think you're a good point there. I mean, it can be hard with to stop the nafs sometimes as well if it gets too powerful inside, right? But sometimes you're right, the emotions can be very hard to stop, especially if it's like a fast train. When the train is in full power speed, yeah, you got to put the brakes on fine. It'll take another 3 miles, 4 miles for that train to come to a complete halt, right? That's how emotions are, and it's quite dangerous to give it that much power. So therefore, the logical side always needs to keep track of it. And you're right, it can be hard to control. Anybody else? Final questions? No? Okay, I hope this has been a beneficial session. Inshallah, inshallah, jazakumullah khair. We'll start something, inshallah, next week with a new series. Jazakumullah khair. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. والرسمات هنا سرور يحلوا تلك السنين.